So today I'll start this topic, which you have already seen, the tight binding model, but applied to a very important material of nanoscience called graphene. So graphene is nothing but a two-dimensional sheet of graphite, carbon atoms. So I need all the color chops today. So carbon, as you know, is a very important element of the periodic table. And today, after the revolution of silicon and transistors and semiconductors, a huge amount of interest in carbon-based materials. And you can have, I'm sure, in the Center for Advanced Materials and everywhere else also, you know that you've heard of graphene, you've heard of fullerene, you've heard of carbon nanotubes. So my focus is on these two-dimensional systems, an exotic phenomena that you can see in this two-dimension. And you can see that already the things that we have introduced will be of relevance. So graphene is going to occupy our focus in both the lectures before lunch, and I will may not be able to really follow exactly the way they have been announced. So it's a two-dimensional sheet of carbon atoms, so-called graphite. Different, again, there seems to be a division between physicists and chemists. I mean, physicists seem to call the graphene, and the chemists call graphite, at least in the books. But then I think languages are getting mixed up now. So what is carbon? Let me just remind you of something very fundamental. I had to learn these things because, I'm trained as a physicist. But as I said, in order to understand materials, you have to know a bit of chemistry. I always ignored my chemistry classes, for which I'm suffering today. But anyway, so what is carbon? See, carbon has how many electrons? Everybody knows this, right? Huh? Six. So it has got six electrons. Each carbon atom has six electrons. So this is very basic, right? Each carbon atom has six electrons. And as Professor Sauropal, he has done more complicated stuff, but you classify them according to their orbits. And so you pretty much have in mind hydrogen-like atoms for the Bohr theory, etc. And what, let me just quickly remind you about the Bohr theory. You have a proton, and what, single proton, and an electron going around, single electron, in hydrogen, right? It's the first element in the periodic table. So there's a Coulomb interaction between the hydrogen and the electron. This interaction is 1/1 the magnitude of R, which means that it's spherically symmetric. You can rotate your coordinate system any way you like, but 1/1 magnitude of R will look the same. So this is called rotational symmetry. And as a result, when you solve the Schrodinger equation, you find, of course, the wave functions will display this rotational symmetry. But the energy eigenvalues also, like, you have three principal quantum numbers, n, l, m, in hydrogen-like atoms, okay? But the energy eigenvalue, when you solve the simple Schrodinger equation for hydrogen atoms, depends only on n, which means that the energy levels are degenerate, that you can have different values of L and M, but if you have the same value of N, you have the same energy. So in quantum mechanics, you say that the energy levels are highly degenerate. Of course, this degeneracy will be lifted, as Sauropal had already said in great detail, that if you bring in other electrons, you continue to may have just one proton or one nucleus. And if you bring in other electrons, then you have interactions between the electrons. So this, therefore, L, M, they all come in. So, but the classification still is based on these three quantum numbers. So N is an integer. It goes from 1, 2, 3, etc. Right? Correct? And L 0, of course. Okay. So if L is equal to 0, you say that, so if, again, for L equal to 0, everything is very spherically symmetric. Because if L is 0, then M has to be equal to 0. So this is spherically symmetric. And so this state is called an S-wave state. So this is all very simple stuff that you already know. If L is equal to 1, then you have P. If L is equal to 2, you have D, etc., etc. Right? And we all know from high school that the way these orbits are distributed, you have something like 2n squared of occupation, right? For if n equal to 1, which is the closest shell, then you can have how many electrons there? 2, right? Right? For n, so you put in 2 because you can have spin of electron up or down. You're not violating the Pauli principle, so you can have 2. So you start out with by filling in the electrons, the 6 electrons that you have. So you have 2 electrons in the n equal to 1 state, so 2s, okay? Right? Sorry, I'm making a mistake. The spectroscopic notation that I will use, so this is for n equal to 1. Please correct me. N equal to 1. And S means that you have S wave, so L equal to 0, M equal to 0. Right? And this may, you can put in 2 electrons because of opposite spins. Then that's a closed shell. Then you go into N equal to 2. Okay? Now for N equal to 2, that is, this is N equal to 2. And then again, you can have 2s, that is still L equal to 0. You put in 2 more. Okay? So remember this formula called 2n squared. For n equal to 1, you have 2. For n equal to 2, you should actually get n squared is 4, so you should get 8. Right? But you don't have 8. You only have to accommodate 4 more electrons. Right? Right? So you have 2 going into 2s and 2 must go into 2p. So this is how the electrons are distributed in a carbon atom. The ones which are closest to the nucleus, they're called the core electrons. These 4 electrons in the outer shell are called valence electrons. And entire chemical bonding, chemical reactions, everything are accentuated by these so-called valence electrons. They'll have wave functions, and then if the wave functions overlap, if I bring 2 carbon atoms together closer, then we will have overlapping of wave functions, because in quantum mechanics, no particle can be localized. They have an extended wave, and when they overlap, there's bonding. Okay? So we will discuss the idea of bonding and antibonding that we had already introduced in the first lecture of mine, and this has cropped up in Chodapal's lecture, D.D. Sharma's lecture, the idea of bonding and antibonding. So remember what we said is that if I have 2 hydrogen-like atoms, which are far apart, the wave functions do not overlap. Each is like an exponentially falling off function. These are the lowest forms of what are called Laguerre polynomials, but that you don't have to worry about so much. And now, this is the ground state wave function. I bring 2 hydrogen atoms close together. The wave functions start overlapping. When they overlap, we don't know which electron is where, right? So you start discussing things in terms of superposition of states. You form from size the 2 wave functions of the 2 individual hydrogen atoms. You form a symmetric state and an antisymmetric state. And you find that the symmetric state has lower energy than the antisymmetric state, all that we discussed in the first lecture. Symmetric state is called bonding state. The antisymmetric state is called antibonding state. So it's an idea based on 2 state atoms, 2 state problems. two-level problem. And from that two-level problem, we built up the entire lattice problem of a tight binding system. So graphene is also going to be constructed like that. And the whole idea of two-level system that you found in the first lecture in terms of linear combination of atomic orbitals or a symmetric double well where the same thing happens. You can have the particle up here or there. So there's an overlap states, and that you construct from the ground state and the first excited state of a single harmonic oscillator. You have degeneracy when the wells are very far apart, when they are brought together. You have tunnel splitting. So all these things actually will occur again in graphene. So what is going to happen is, so how am I going to then look at these wave functions? All right? Don't have to worry about core electrons anymore. They are outside our reckoning because nothing in chemistry will depend on the core electrons until you can eject them by some external agency. So we're going to worry only about valence electrons. So schematically, how do you write a 2s2 wave function? So this is spherically symmetric, so I'll draw a circle. Okay? And the convention that I will use is that if the wave function is positive, see the wave function can be both positive and negative, right? So if the wave function is positive, I'll indicate that by these hatches, all right? So what do you mean by positive? Let me remind you again that, for instance, in this double well problem, or I think you more like the bonding antibonding of hydrogen-like atoms, that remember that we had two hydrogen atoms. This is something in the first lecture itself. You have two hydrogen atoms, and you have two wave function like that. You bring them together, you start doing a linear combination, so you call it psi 1 and psi 2, and then you have 1 over root 2 psi 1 plus psi 2, and another state called 1 over root 2 psi 1 minus psi 2. These are the two only linearly independent linear combinations that you can form out of psi 1 and psi 2. And now, so look at psi 1 plus psi 2. I add the two wave functions. So I get, so when I overlap this state, call it psi plus, so psi plus would be schematically like that. This will be psi plus. But psi 1 minus psi 2 means that I'm actually subtracting psi 2. So I get, therefore, when I do this, I'll have an antisymmetric wave function like that. And precisely because of this, I call this the bonding state. And this is called antibonding because the electron has a substantial chance or opportunity of spending time in between the two protons. And so the Coulomb energy would be lowered. And therefore, you have binding. And here, you have antibinding because you go through a node at the middle. So that's the reason of why Pauling called them bonding and antibonding states. I mean, classic book written in the 1930s. Okay, but so, what do we mean by these green lines? So wherever the wave function has a positive amplitude, we indicate by blue. Here the wave function is negative, so I don't write anything. I just keep it empty. So this is a convention. The convention that I saw in a very nice review article by Saito and two Dresselhaus, as well as a couple of Dresselhaus. They are big names in the carbon-based materials. So, okay. So here is the schematic 2s state. Now, what about 2p? 2p is no longer spherically symmetric. And remember, Saurabh Pal already introduced that p, therefore, in chemistry at least, you know, you can have these three possibilities. Because L equal to 1 means I have three projections for M. M can be either plus 1 or 0 or minus 1, the magnetic quantum number. And accordingly, you write this. So therefore, if you have a right-handed coordinate system, so you see I'm going extremely slow, but this is important that some of these ideas does sink in. I mean, you have all seen this before. So how do I schematically represent a px wave function? So the px wave function will look like a wing of a butterfly. So this is your x direction. This is parallel to this x axis. And so, you know, you can have either this sort of a thing or that sort of thing, right? Okay. So this is px. What about py? Py is similar. You have a butterfly going like that, butterfly wing, like this. And pz will therefore be like that. Okay. So now you think of this 2p2, these two electrons, which can be either plus spin or minus spin. So they can be either in the px or py or pz. So suppose I consider the pz, 2pz. Then what is going to happen is, you have this. Sorry. Now you have two possibilities, either that or this. Symmetric, my drawing is not perfect. Either this or that. So if you have this, so clearly there's the electron up here, which has a wave function positive, will be sucked in, right? And you have a situation similar to this, that you in fact consider, here there will be kind of a repulsion because the wave function here is positive, is further away. And so you now have a possibility of bonding here and antibonding here. And this phenomenon is called hybridization. That is, if I now bring two carbon atoms close together, the two S wave function of one of the carbon atoms will overlap with the 2P wave function of the other carbon atoms, causing what is called sp2 hybridization. Right? So in graphene, in fullerene, you have a bunch of hybridized carbon atoms, sp2 hybridized carbon atoms. You have sp2 bonding, and if you have also, these are given names. These are called sigma bonds in the literature. If you bring in also py pz, there's no reason why on earth you should only have pz. If you bring in px and py, they give you somewhat weaker bonds, and this is called pi bond, right? Now, have you all seen this thing before? You're shaking your head. The physics student, our chemistry students?
Yeah.
You have seen this all. That's bigger here, huh? Okay. So now we get into, so what happens in graphene? So you now construct this from two carbon atoms, you go on adding